Thank you for joining us again at our Sunday evening service. We begin tonight with a hymn. It's a hymn called All People That on Earth Do Dwell, words that are taken from Psalm 100. After we hear the hymn, Junior will read from John chapter 10 and pray before we study God's word together.
Gospel chapter 10 and verse 7, and if you have a Bible you can read along. John 10 and verse 7. Then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring. And they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. And down to verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Amen. And we trust God to bless his word to us this evening. Let's just pray together. Our Father, we come to you tonight and we thank you for your goodness to us. As we look at a week that has gone past, Father, as we reflect on, Lord, your blessings that you've bestowed upon us, we just want to say thank you. With the psalmist, we're truly able to say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. And Father, we come this evening just with thankful hearts, Lord. There is so much in this world, perhaps that could get us down as we look at the bad news and the negative. And yet, Father, we thank you for moments like these when we can reflect upon your goodness and your grace and your blessings. And Father, we just pray that as we would come to listen to your word now, we pray for the pastor. We pray that you might speak through him into each of our lives. We thank you, Father, that while you've given us so much, Lord, most of all, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who, Lord, we've been reading about tonight, being the good shepherd who cares for his sheep. And Father, we thank you for Christ, who is not only willing to come to this earth, but was willing to go all the way to Calvary and to die for our sin and to take our punishment and our place. And Father, we thank you that through him we not only have salvation and forgiveness of sins, but we can come to you in prayer and address you as our heavenly Father. And so, Lord, we just commit our time to you. We pray that you give us not only listening ears, but Father, you give us an understanding heart. And Father, a will that is wanting to obey you in all that you would say to us tonight. And so, Father, we just commit the pastor to you and all that he says. And bless it, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Junior. 3 years ago, the international sheepdog trials came to Guildhall, just outside Dromore, and that event put Dromore well and truly on the map. It attracted visitors from as far away as China, Canada, Australia, and Brazil. There were visitors, in fact, from 25 different countries, all to watch some very clever sheepdogs control some very stupid sheep. Sheep aren't really that clever. Sheep don't even come close to the top 10 smartest animals. That's reserved for chimpanzees, dolphins, elephants, squirrels, cats, dogs, crows, and even pigs. Sheep, unfortunately, are in the Dumb and Dumber League along with pandas and turkeys. They wander from home, they eat plants, they get lost. It's no wonder you don't see any sheep in the circus. And if there was an animal version of Mastermind, sadly, there wouldn't be any sheep getting past the qualifying round. But the strange thing is, the Bible compares us to these foolish animals. The Bible time and time again says that we are like sheep. Well, if we are sheep, then we most certainly need a shepherd. And in John 10, we read that Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Jesus makes seven of these I am statements in John's Gospel. In January, we examined probably the best known one in John 14, verse 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And in every one of these I am statements, Jesus is affirming that he is indeed God in the flesh. The message to Moses in Exodus chapter 3 at the burning bush, God said, tell them, I am has sent you. In Matthew chapter 9, we hear about the Lord Jesus Christ visiting the local villages and cities. He healed people from diseases, from afflictions. And we're told in verse 36 of that chapter, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And in these verses that were read for us tonight from John chapter 10, Jesus builds on this picture of himself as the good shepherd. Throughout the Bible, God is referred to as the shepherd and his people refer to as sheep. Our opening hymn, as we said, was taken from Psalm 100. Verse 3 of that psalm says, "Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us. We are His. We are the people and the sheep of His pasture." Psalm 95, verse 7, "For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand." Isaiah 40, verse 11, "He will tend His flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in His arms." And as we study John 10 this evening, there are three things we see about the Good Shepherd. Firstly, we see the Good Shepherd knows the sheep. Verse 14, "I am the Good Shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own." It's remarkable to watch a shepherd tending his sheep, and if I'm honest, one sheep looks exactly like the next one. But a true shepherd knows his sheep individually. He knows their different markings. He knows those who limp a bit, those who are healthy, those who are hard work, those who are easy going. He's interested in every one of his sheep, old and young. And if one of them goes missing, he won't stop searching until he's found the lost one. The shepherds in Jesus' time in Israel would have named their sheep after, according to their appearance and according to their temperament. One might be called grumpy, another dozy, another happy, another sleepy. But also in Jesus' day, there were bad shepherds in Israel, and Jesus described them as thieves and robbers and strangers. They were a disgrace to the shepherd industry. They would desert their sheep in times of danger. Some of them were inexperienced, and the sheep weren't able to find good pasture. These shepherds would just leave them on their own. Jesus described them as hard hands. They didn't own the sheep, so they didn't know them, and they didn't care for them, and they didn't protect them. But the good shepherd, a good shepherd knows his sheep. He cared for them, he loved his animals, he protected them, and he never left them alone. He made sure they had shade from the burning sun. He made sure they had shelter in times of storm. And the Lord Jesus Christ, the good shepherd, knows every one of his sheep. He adds at the end of verse 14, how intimately he knows his sheep. "Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father." Jesus says he knows us as individuals exactly the same way as he knows his Father. And he knew his Father before the world began. He knew his Father intimately, experientially, eternally, and perfectly. No one knows us better than the Lord Jesus. And the knowledge that the Good Shepherd has of his people goes to the very deepest recesses of our hearts and our lives. And Psalm 139 tells us that the Lord Jesus knew us even before we were born. "My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me when as yet there was none of them." And the Good Shepherd is intimately involved with every one of his people, those who are trusting him, those who are following him. He knows everything about us, every minute detail. And because he is God, he lives inside us by his Holy Spirit. He knows our gifts, our struggles, our tears, our hurts, our secrets, our temptations, our doubts, our fears. And perhaps as you watch this recording this evening as a believer, you're going through a time of great uncertainty, even insecurity. Struggles with your health, struggles with your family's health. Listen, let me remind you again tonight, the Good Shepherd is with you every step of the journey, and he is the one who holds the future, and he will guide you with his hand. He protects us from our enemies. He shelters us when the heat is on. He shelters us whenever the storm is raging. What a wonderful shepherd is Jesus. He cares, he heals, he guides, he protects, and he knows us better than we know ourselves. And the great privilege of being a Christian is not only that Jesus knows us, we can know him experientially as well. We can read all about him in the Bible, we can talk to him in prayer, and listen, the more we get to know him, the more we find him true, and the more we wish that others would get to know him too. He's not just any shepherd. He's the good shepherd, the excellent shepherd, the lovely shepherd, the preeminent shepherd, the shepherd above all shepherds. The good shepherd knows his sheep. But also in these verses we see that the good shepherd speaks to his sheep. Verse 16, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Verse 27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Recently, a man in Australia was arrested and charged with stealing a sheep, but he claimed emphatically that it was one of his own that had been missing for a few days. Whenever the case went to court, the judge was puzzled, not knowing how to decide the matter. At last, he asked that the sheep be brought into the courtroom. Then he ordered the plaintiff to step outside and to call the animal. The sheep made absolutely no response except to raise its head and look frightened and confused. The judge then instructed the defendant to go to the courtyard and to call the sheep. Whenever the accused began to make his distinctive call, the sheep bounded towards the door. It was obvious that he recognised the familiar voice of his master. If I went into a field of sheep beside us here and spoke to them or even shouted at them, more than likely they would completely ignore me. They wouldn't pay any attention because they wouldn't recognise my voice, just like the man in Australia. But whenever the shepherd speaks, they respond because he speaks with familiarity. And so it is with the voice of the Lord Jesus. And his voice today is heard whenever the Bible is read and whenever the Bible is expounded. And Jesus speaks with the voice of ultimate authority and ultimate power. The voice that raises the dead. And perhaps as you watch this recording tonight, you're not yet a follower of Jesus. You've heard about him. You know certain information about him. You've an amount of head knowledge. However, like many people, that 18 inches from your head to your heart is proving to be a significant barrier. Head knowledge isn't enough. There has to be the heart response whenever he speaks, and perhaps he's been speaking to your heart in recent weeks and months. Once again today, he speaks in the gospel. He loves you. He has proved his love for you beyond measure, beyond contradiction, by going to the cross, and he calls you tonight to leave your sin, to leave your regrets, and he will welcome you unconditionally into his fold. And you don't have to work at cleaning yourself up or trying to be a better child, a better parent, a better husband, a better wife. He speaks and he invites you to come to him just the way you are. Lastly, and most importantly, in these verses we see that the Good Shepherd dies for the sheep. Five times in these verses, Jesus says he lays down his life for the sheep. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Same thing in verse 15, the same thing in verse 17, twice in verse 18. Every November and Remembrance Sunday, we pause and reflect to pay tribute to those who paid the ultimate sacrifice by laying down their lives and the two world wars, also in the troubles in this country. Jesus himself said, greater love has no one than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. But all who died on the battlefield died for their country, their king, their queen, their friends. Jesus Christ died for his enemies. And he died willingly and he died voluntarily. Verse 18, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down to myself. His father didn't have to coerce him, didn't have to twist his arm or to pay him to convince him to leave heaven, to be born in a lowly stable and to come to this earth to be fully God, yet fully man, to live the life that we could never live, a life of perfection, a spotless life. Yet the Bible tells us that on the first Good Friday, he died on the cross. He was crucified, executed like a common criminal between two thieves. Why would this happen to someone so innocent, so perfect, so faultless? Well, the truth is, this is the only way we could have a relationship with God. Someone had to pay for our vast catalogue of sins. And in those verses that we looked at last Sunday evening from Isaiah 53, written 700 years before the birth of Christ, we read, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. the iniquity of us all. Someone had to bridge the gap between a holy, perfect, just God and sinners like us. And Jesus, the Good Shepherd, was the only one who could achieve this. He took our place. He was punished instead of us. And Isaiah 53 continues, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter and like a sheep before its shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. The Good Shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ, went to the cross willingly, laid down his life for us. And just like a sacrificial lamb, he never said a word. This is how he loves us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I have a shepherd, one I love so well. How he has blessed me, tongue can never tell. On the cross he suffered, shed his blood, and died, that I might ever in his love abide. Can you grasp this evening? This astonishing truth that the Good Shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ, took the sinner's place on the cross. We deserve to be on that cross paying for our own sins, but the Good Shepherd laid down his life for us, the perfect for the imperfect, the just for the unjust, the sinless for the sinful. He is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And the Lamb who died to save us is the Good Shepherd who lives to lead us. Stories told of a Scottish Highland shepherd boy who bedded his sheep down for the night just before a ferocious storm raged through the valley. Next morning, the boy awoke to discover to his horror that the viaduct running over the valley had collapsed. The train track lay broken in the valley. The shepherd boy ran quickly to the embankment to stop the train. He arrived just as the train was coming, and he waved to the conductor, but the conductor waved him away. So the boy threw his body across the track. The conductor slammed on the brakes, ran over the boy, stopped before the train descended into the valley's abyss. Most of the people on the train were oblivious to what was happening. They were sleeping. They got out when they heard the brakes screeching. They ran outside the train. They looked at the broken track and the mangled remains of the boy, and no one said a word for a few minutes. Then finally one old man spoke up and said, "That boy there saved my life." The Lord Jesus Christ on the cross gave his life a ransom for many. Gave it all away on the cross. And he's speaking to you tonight in the gospel. Will you say, as you look to the cross tonight, "That God-man there saved my life"? Will you say with Paul in Galatians 2:20, "The Son of God loved me and gave himself for me"? Tonight, if you're not a believer, the call of the gospel comes to you once again. The invitation to come to Christ, who laid down his life for us, who bore the wrath of God for us, so that we may be forgiven, so that we can be declared righteous. And because of the death of the Good Shepherd and his resurrection 3 days later, we can go free if we repent of our sin, acknowledge that our sin has deeply offended God, and believe this glorious gospel. Romans 10:9, I've quoted it on a number of occasions during the last 14 months. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You can be saved tonight. You can respond to the gospel tonight as you listen to this recording right where you are. But listen, it's absolutely vital that if the Good Shepherd has spoken to you, that you respond. Don't put it off. Because 1 Peter 5:4 tells us, when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Jesus is coming back. No one knows the day or hour, but he's coming back for his sheep, and he's coming back to take them home. So it's imperative that you're ready to meet him when the chief shepherd returns. Come tonight to this wonderful, welcoming shepherd. Then you will know the meaning of true life, life with purpose, life with meaning, and ultimately life with supreme, unshakable hope. And then you'll be able to say with David in Psalm 23 verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We thank God for his precious word to our hearts this evening. Let's just close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for these I am statements in John's Gospel, affirming the fact that Jesus is God in the flesh. Thank you for this lovely statement in John 10 that he is the good shepherd, the good shepherd who laid down his life for the sheep. Thank you tonight that we're still able to proclaim this wonderful gospel. We're still in the day of grace. We pray for your people this evening that they would know again tonight the truth, the unchanging truth, that the good shepherd cares for them, loves them, and will protect them every step of the journey. And dear Father, for anyone watching tonight still outside of Christ, still in great danger without Christ, we pray that they would take on board very seriously that the truth from your word tonight, that they would realize the seriousness, the gravity, the problem of their sin, and they would turn to Jesus Christ, the only Savior of sinners, the one who laid down his life for the sheep on that cross 2,000 years ago outside the city of Jerusalem. Thank you that we're still in the day of grace. Thank you that Jesus Christ defeated sin and Satan and death. He's alive forevermore, waiting to one day return as the chief shepherd to take us home. May everyone watching this recording be ready for that great and ominous day. We give you thanks. In our Saviour's name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for watching. God bless you. If you have any questions, as usual, please contact us through our Facebook page. We're here to help. God bless.